So Asok Sen, intriguing growth breakdown dynamics and strong memory aspect in the RRTN model of many complex systems of nature. Okay. Why an announcement?
So no. Okay. The name title has already been told, and oh my God. Okay, I'm going to talk about first of all some nonlinear response in some systems, variously called soft condensed matter or complex systems or whatever. And also, many of these things showed very low, ultra low population threshold. For example, this one here, there's a transmission in electron micrograph, the results, the first author of many people there, including Professor Higar, is Raghu, who is, of course, a professor at Indian Institute of Science, experimentalist. So this is polyaniline. Polyaniline doped with camphor sulfonic acid in, on a PMMA base, polyblend films. And this one has, for example, they did it. This is very, very painstaking. This is 3D sample, and in 3D, different bond or other kinds of site percolation will tell you that the numerically calculated percolation threshold is around 0.18, 0.2, something like that. And this one has a percolation threshold of 0.3%. So volume fraction is 0.003. And long, I think this is 1994. That's where they finally stabilized in their results. Previously, they got 0.005, 0.004, and 0.003 is what they said. And so people have to throw away, I mean, this annealing of this is in a solidal method, of course, it's very difficult, one can understand. This is non-percolating one, less than 0.003. And so these are the kinds of things. In our institute, we have also one experimentalist, Komal Vardhan. He found similar things in certain kind of carbon powder mixed on, put on wax, and the percolation threshold there is also much less than 1%. And from that, and also from the temperature behavior, I came to the conclusion after a long time looking at the experiments that here some kind of tunneling behavior, some non-classical behavior has to be taken. So what we do is that in many such systems, for example, Zener diode, where the quantum mechanics with the phase may not be that much necessary, in many electrical circuits also, but the tunneling part is taken. And Zener diode, of course, is one such situation, and one has a threshold for that. So so this is taking tunneling. So this is, first of all, definitely semi-classical, does not have any phase information. And the most important part is to have a threshold. Zener diode will not have the symmetry, of course. But then in such experiments, for example, in some of the things with Zener diodes in similar situations where almost done on the tabletop by Professor Ben Gigi once in one of his talks. And so if one puts these Zener diodes randomly, then one can almost get this situation. Anyway, so I see that this in the electrical paradigm, what we find, you know, of course, this is one of the things that people do everywhere, different kinds of breakdown, fracture, and other phenomena people do in the paradigm of electrical systems, because then the main quantity is a scalar, it's not any tensor property, tensor quantity, and it becomes easy then to go to larger system size. Nowadays, one can go to very large system size, but that's a different thing. The problems were being done for a long time in the electrical paradigm. And I find with the introduction of this kind of simplified behavior of a semi-classical kind of percolation, many things which I didn't expect when I was doing basically static behavior, nonlinear response, and all these things. Later on, when I do time dynamics, I find that somehow they get the essence of those things very well. And so, so the main point then I keep on emphasizing is that like a very steep, not steep, I mean, very large exponent in the exponential, and for a while one may think of it, Zenadad I have already told, but even theoretically if one considers that there is a very sharp change from some point onwards, and we do not need to go to very high voltages, these are all microscopic bonds that I'm talking about at this time now. And so then, if we do not want to or need to go to very high value of the voltage here or the energy here, then this behaves reasonably well for the percolation problem. And also gives the results in many other similar cases. For example, we all know about the friction in mechanical systems. And so that also has a threshold. And it has the friction value, friction coefficient is less until and unless it moves. And when it starts to move, then you have the coefficient of dynamic friction, which is smaller. So instead of looking at friction, if we look at one of our friction, which is like conductance, then it is a similar kind of behavior that we are seeing here. Similar things, some sort of stone or in which you have porous pathways, tubes, microtubules, and then of course you have to, for any particular tubule with some radius, there will be capillary forces, and you have to send force from outside, say oil recovery, tertiary oil recovery, and one puts micellar solution, some soap solution kind of thing through that to reduce the surface tension, and still one has to give some pressure to take the fluids out. In any case, due to different diameters, that thing also becomes random. We will, in our percolation problem, we will not put the randomness there, but in the positions and all these things. So this is what goes in, and tunneling simply happens to be a word historically connected, and in the place of such tunneling, one can put many other behavior, many other quantities, and then it applies to various kinds of response functions then. Oh my God. Okay, so here is one such example of our network. This is a square bond percolation, and one knows that the exact value of the percolation threshold, I have not shown the bonds with which are insulators, only let's say the ohmic bonds are shown here. And then this going through the barrier, that with the threshold, that's what we have shown. We have taken, like good old physicists, only for one lattice constant only, and not at all, not any more than that, and try to see what we can derive from there. So whenever two such bonds are within a lattice constant, then given enough voltage from outside, whenever for that particular bond, let's say I was talking about this, it is greater than, let's say I've used 0.5 extensively for whatever reason, and it's also written there. That's P is equal to 0.5. So anyway, you can put any threshold that you want. And then what happens is, at P equal to 0.3, the RRN did not percolate. And this is a 20 by 20 size sample, RRN. And when the voltage is very high, so all these dashed bonds are those T bonds coming up at some value of the external field or other. And so this is what we call a maximal RRTN for a finite V. Not all the T bonds will come up, but some of them will come up, and it will go to its saturation value of the current or whatever, but if the RRTN percolates. So this we did real space normalization group to find the percolation threshold, and we find that for the maximal RRTN, instead of 0.5, you have 0.181. So clearly, Realistically speaking, if we take tunneling possible to not just through the first lattice constant, but up to second lattice constant, then of course it will go even much below 0.18. And 3D starts with about 0.2 anyway, and so it will go even lower. Collect enough mental power to go to 3D and all. We have mean field theories for that, but this will be very heavy, and there were many other interesting problems that we wanted to do on these, and we are still doing some of them. Two such results we will tell you. So there are many other interesting things we can use this as a sort of lab or like an experiment for a theoretician, and there are many interesting things come out anyway. So sort of stick to that. So I will be talking mostly about the dynamics here. Dynamics comes because of the T-bonds. Typically, what happens? Okay. This is a static situation. This P is about 0.7, 40 by 40 size system. And up to about a very small value of small VG was the threshold for the microscopic T-bonds. The ohmic bonds do not have, of course, VG equal to zero there, if at all. And these things combined in a combined form will give a capital VG, of course. And this capital VG is somewhere here. And then, so up to that, because it is P equal to 0.7 in 2D, so there is a lower ohmic regime. And this almost like logarithmically goes to an upper ohmic regime. And very many interesting things happen here. And typically in the RRN, as we know, that this thing works. The change in current proportional to the minus of the current value. And then you have what is called, to you all physicists call it a Boltzmann relaxation time approximation. I'll go very far from there. So far from equilibrium, actually, I'd like to say far from steady state. And other interesting things happen then. First, a lot of examples. We were doing this, and we found two initial power laws. And I thought, oh, now I have gotten this the death of the of our model. I kept on asking many people all over the world. Believe it or not, also Professor Eugene Stanley. He was in Bombay at that time. Here in Bangalore, he came to give the Raman lecture at that time. Anyway, so, but then I keep on looking at physics today, and sometimes it helps me understand the problem from physics today instead of physics B or physics whatever. So here there was an article, review article by these liquid state people, Bender, and other such, Lewis group, forget the name. So anyway, they were looking at many different things. And for example, amorphous silicon hydrogenated. And then there were three decades of, and looking at photo emission from there, and the current, photocurrent. And for about three decades, one power law, another three decades, another three or four decades, another power law. And so when I found this, I said, okay, maybe then our model is not that bad. So these are some, and he has many other examples. This is blinking kinetics in, probably these red things cannot be read very well, I think. But anyway, cadmium selenide quantum dots, the blinking kinetics, and they are also at least one power. I look, you know, the beauty is in the eyes of the beholder. And here I am, of course, sort of blind with my love, I believe. I seem to find that there is another power law here. Anyway, so and also earthquake. Earthquake, this has been seen by many people, and this Japanese guy, Omori, has a law. This is after the main shock. At least for two decades, it's a power law. This one, the foreshock is more difficult to get. And but in earthquakes of the order in the Richter scale, at least at about 7 or 8, instrumentations also have become better. People find power law at least for two more decades. This one is well known to geophysicists as Omori's law. Two power laws, again. These are canonical examples. What they find, one of them is 1.5, this one, and the 0.5 other one adds up to 2. But in more complex systems, that kind of thing does not happen, like in earthquake or reassociation of iron in folded heme proteins, means myoglobin or hemoglobin. There is a paper by them in PRL also, Parag Freundfelder and all, they are microbiologists. So they find, I have not shown the graph here, they also find at least one power law, and Salis says he has written that paper also that that actually two power laws. There are some other examples. One in our homegrown sputtering particles on the surface by Sangam Energy and others. This is a computer experiment by Aharoni and Mandelbrot. And this is a, believe me, temperature, it's a time-like quantity. Again, two power laws. This is calcium channel dynamics. This is a PRL by the theorists, and they took the results from biologists. And so they report in the PRL that there is one power law, but again, I say that there is another power law here for at least one decade. How much time I have?
7 minutes?
Okay. And we use, oh my God, I don't know what symbol came here. This is simply equal to. And so simply continuity equation with Kirchhoff's law sort of thing. And so sometimes we call it a lattice Kirchhoff's dynamics. And we are looking at, this was published in Neurophysics Letters and in 2005. And so we find two different ways that it can give two different power laws. This one was taken by the referee quite well, because this was not seen, this was not, theory couldn't yet explain that. And also here one cannot say probably this is only a sub-exponential, and so one is making two different straight lines out of that. And even if one says that here, one cannot say that there, and the referee somehow found that and says that this should be looked for much more carefully. By the way, the calcium dynamics says finds something like this, if you remember that picture over there. Theory didn't, couldn't as yet find such a thing. Why two power law could be one reason that, there is first of all some clustering effect going on at a small length scale, somewhat larger than the particle size, and so we are doing that actually in our algebra through the local continuity equation. The equation that we are doing as Kirchhoff's dynamics is basically continuity equation, must hold, you know, more or less at every point, but it doesn't. We do locally, and to see, so this is like a local invariance or local symmetry trying to go towards a global symmetry, and until and unless the steady state appears, which is a non-equilibrium state, of course, and that the current at the beginning layer and the end layer are not the same. So there are two possible length scales, and that could be the reason of this shape invariant. That's what Bendler and Montreal and they said in the physics today, shape invariant. Power law does not have any scale, and this is another example of scale-free situation. But more interesting things occurs here, because it does not remain scale-free. The system has a fantastic memory. That's a story for today. I don't know how far I can go. Also, I don't want to run very fast. Because there are lots of students. That other than the pictorial thing, mathematically speaking, what is happening, and again, it looks very bad, please excuse me, minus sign with the this thing. It is e to the power minus t by tau. And if there are many time constants, relaxation time in the system, and typically when W2 is like power law, then what happens is, basically, it becomes the Fourier transform of that density, the fault density of certain kind, and I don't know. It's not a mix up of various different phases, but somehow there are many different time constants in the system, and so one integrates over this thing, and Fourier transform of power law becomes another power, Laplace transform. So that is, mathematically speaking, that is the point. And this I tried to show a little bit. Unfortunately, if I make it this way, then very little can be understood. So please believe me, what I'm showing here in the dynamics that at different times after we impose, we want to see how the this is called dielectric breakdown. and the so it's like a fracture, and so how it propagates. So in this case, to see how it propagates, okay, I'll come to different kinds of initial condition. This initial condition is such that this end is the place where you apply the voltage, and this is the one which you have the earth zero voltage. And so here you give like a sudden impulse. All the voltage that you have to give, you give it here, and then it propagates. It's like a ductile fracture. Here I have done the opposite thing so that tunneling can be looked at even from behind reasonably well. Here the dotted lines are the random resistor network, and these tunneling lines comes with a full line. This is a progress up to about this much at a time of about 20, and then about time about 100, it has progressed some more. Here it has progressed some more. And this is time, believe me, this is in my discrete time scale of one lattice scan. This is 1134 for that particular iSeed with which the sample was created. And this finally goes some more because of the voltage or the field, and that's the steady state. I want to show another thing here, that if we change the initial conditions, initial voltage distribution, instead of the one that I just talked about, random voltage configuration, still, doggedly always the result comes here, up to any digit of accuracy you want. So with a double precision. But the thing is that here it is a log scale, so changes are quite a bit. What happens, the exponents are not quite the same. Here it is shown even much more clearly. The exponents are not quite the same. We take out this part, subtract that. And so that is like something like, if not noise, but actually close to chaoticity. And some various problems occur whenever some system is close to chaoticity. In this case, some entropic problems also do occur. I will not talk about entropy today. It's a different issue. I myself have to gain some more confidence in those things. Anyway, so two power laws are there, it goes to a steady state value, which is doggedly the same for all such situations. And one of the things, this is of course empirical, that in the case of Boltzmann kind of first order linear differential equation, this is the one Boltzmann equation, chemists call it Debye relaxation or whatever, and two other terms will give this kind of behavior. And those two, one again, sort of thinks that this locally different kinds of configurations, locally amorphous configurations through which we are trying to get through. So, as I said, this is empirical, and this can give two different exponents, Q minus 1, 1 over Q minus 1 will be alpha 1, and 1 over R minus 1 will be the alpha 2. And here we show how strong is the memory. Very, very different. Now, I'm changing the initial condition abruptly, tremendously. Okay, so now you can see very clearly that, of course, from here, some others go in this way. And the one, it is coming, that one of them goes below where it is supposed to go, starts from above, it goes below where it is supposed to go, and yet finally changes itself, comes back, and gets this this value. And not only this is only one quantity for the whole circuit, whole network. Well, I have looked at all such things, and the configuration is also same. It is not due to any degeneracy. It gets to the same configuration, tremendous memory effect. And this is one thing. And the other is that the one that I showed the curve, how the fracture front or dielectric breakdown front propagates from one end of the system to the other. For that one, it has to cross the other end of the circuit to the earth end to get any current at all. This is that time. Call it a sojourn time, or call it a breakdown time, or whatever. So this is the breakdown time. And if the initial ohmic RRN, if it has a constant, can I get a little bit more? Just, I'm sorry.
3 minutes to go.
Okay. So I'm looking at the, sorry, yes. The ratio of those two times, the RRN has a relaxation time, that is calculated very fast, and a different time, different size. This is a 40 size system, and the other one is 80 size system. It is becoming very narrow, and the peak is becoming higher also, and so we take the peak value, the median value instead of any average. The self-averaging breaks in such situations. Oops. So I'm plotting the median, the peak value here as a function of the length and goes to a pretty constant value very fast. So this has important implications. I was lucky, I believe, that within a length of about 200. So this says, first of all, there is only one parameter scaling. Both of the breakdown time and the RRN relaxation time are not independent. So that's the first thing. And once parameter scaling, I'm using something like semi-classical, semi-quantum theory. That's why I'm saying that like Anderson tension, like one parameter scaling. The second one is more important. If one knows the relaxation time from the conductivity calculation of the random resistor network, then one can get the breakdown time also, the first time the current will go through the whole circuit. And this is on which, this is a million-dollar question. This is, of course, random still, but because very narrow one tends to go towards, in the large length limit, tends to go towards a constant value. So if you know the so-called steady-state value, and if you know the conductivity or whatever property, elastic constant or other thing, this result tends to say that this constant says you can get the other one. And then we are looking at this memory attribute. This memory attribute is very, very important in that from wherever we start, it goes to the same value. This system can go towards chaotic situation also. So I'm not saying only this thing happened in the RRTN. Chaotic situations also happens. But anyway, because of this, this has a very, very important application, should in principle, for cognition, cognitive property, also fault tolerant cryptography and public key crypto systems. This is something which has been published in the IEEE Computer Society in that journal. But that's all I would like to say.
Thank you. Any questions? Well, if not, let's thank the speaker again. So it's good that we went up to the end of the time, because the time was